Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting companies, we have a philosophy here to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Brad Bialy, Director of Digital Marketing with Haley Marketing Group. Brad is passionate about helping organizations develop and implement strategic digital marketing strategies to reach defined business goals. Since 2016, Brad has motivated and educated thousands of staffing industry members through nearly 100 industry-specific conferences and webinar series. He has helped oversee the social media and content marketing strategy and comprehensive marketing education for over 300 staffing and recruiting firms, guiding the strategy and delivering multiple industry award-winning social media campaigns. Haley Marketing focuses exclusively on servicing the staffing industry and recruiting industry. Websites, social media, blog writing, marketing automation, email marketing, SEO, PPC, corporate identity, strategy, you name it. Whether you're looking to drive sales leads or attract more qualified candidates, they provide the marketing tools and technology for you to stand out in a saturated market. The staffing industry has had an amazing run over the past decade, but the times have changed. Selling staffing has become harder, a lot harder. To make matters worse, recruiting is still a challenge. 30% of staffing companies did not survive the last two recessions. So don't be a statistic. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Brad skips the doom and gloom and shares practical ideas to level up your marketing to generate more leads, improve sales efficiency, and outperform your competitors in today's economy. Key takeaways will be specific strategies to level up your marketing by strengthening your positioning, messaging, website, online reputation, and more. Learn how account managers can be more productive by modernizing your sales tools. Best lead gen tactics for today's economy, strategies successful companies have used during the past recessions to minimize loss, accelerate recovery, and drive growth at more than double the rate of the staffing industry. If you're ready to level up, I'll turn the floor over to Brad.
And I just want to say thank you to you and TRICOM for having us this afternoon. Friends, I'm excited to get started, and I'm excited to talk about 8 strategies to drive sales in a down economy. Throughout the presentation, if you have any questions, I know Amanda will be monitoring the window. Feel free to use that window. We can answer those at the end. We can answer those during, whatever works well for you. I certainly want to make sure that I'm available to answer those questions as they come in. But again, we're going to talk about 8 ways to drive sales in a down economy. Friends, let's be honest. 2023 is off to a challenging start. When we look at unemployment, we've reached 3.6% unemployment. And on the other side of that, over 311,000 jobs were added in February alone. Now, to me, that sounds like a bit of a conflicting message. We have unemployment, arguably the lowest it's been since right around the time we put a man on the moon, paired with jobs continuing to be added into the economy. So we have jobs being added, but we don't necessarily have the right people for those jobs. At 3.6% unemployment, we're basically fully employed, right? So we have this conflicting nature of, well, unemployment's low, but jobs are being added. And when we think about that and we think about leveling up, we need to make sure we're doing everything we can to make sure that we put our best foot forward in 2023 to combat these numbers. Now, there's a great quote that I love here. And as we look at level up and all the imagery here, it's going to be video game related. We got to throw a shout out to Ash Ketchum Pikachu, right? You got to keep smiling. No matter how tough things are getting, you got to keep smiling. Now, I'm sure you're sitting at your desk and maybe even making time for this webinar alone was a challenge. Maybe you're thinking there are 1,000 things I could be doing instead of listening to Brad talk about marketing and the things that get him fired up. I could be making calls. I could be prospecting. I could be reaching out to those candidates that I know are in my database. The list goes on and on. And I know, given the industry, and I know some of the calls that I'm a part of and what I'm hearing throughout the industry, it is a little bit doom and gloom. And I'm here to say, listen, we can keep smiling no matter how tough things are getting. We know that we're going to get through this, and we know we're going to be on the other side of this shortly. Friends, today, I'm here to say we can't approach 2023 the same as we did in 2022 and expect better results. Frankly, we cannot do it. It's a different game. It's a different economy. It's a different landscape. And when we think about recruiting, we think about staffing, we think about selling staffing services or selling our recruiting services, the tactics and the strategies that we deploy cannot be the same as they were last year because we're playing a different game in 2023. So if you're sitting there today at your desk doing the same things you were doing this time last year, I'm here to say it's time to shake things up and it's time to level up. Now, throughout this presentation, we're going to talk about 8 strategies for leveling up your marketing in 2023. I want to offer a bit of a disclaimer. And if you've seen me talk on the TRICOM webinar series before, you know that I've said this disclaimer just about every single time. I'm going to share 8 strategies, 8 tips, 8 tactics, 8 things that you can do to level up your marketing. That is in no way, shape, or form meant to overwhelm. I don't expect you to leave today and say, listen, we need to do all of this. My hope for you is that you leave with one item that you can deploy this afternoon or tomorrow, just one. And if you can leave with one fact, one piece of information, one tactic that you can deploy, well, then I would have done my job. If you leave with 2, that's even better. We're going to talk about a lot of things, and the goal is to give you a lot to choose from, give you a lot of tools in that toolbox so that you can start where you're most comfortable. So let's level up. First way that we can level up is we need to level up our positioning. What makes you unique, and where would I find you in the grocery store? We all have uniques, yet as I talk to staffing and recruiting firms time and time again, our differentiators start to sound the exact same, and our differentiators don't really differentiate us at all. So I would challenge you as you leave this webinar, maybe this is what you get started with right here, and this is the one takeaway. What makes you unique? When you think about your organization, what do you offer? What do you deliver that your competitors cannot promise and cannot guarantee? What is that unique that you can showcase across all other areas of your marketing mix or even just your business mix? The second point, where would I find you in the grocery store? Friends, I want you to go on a journey with me. If you close your eyes for a second, and obviously I can't see you, so I don't know if you're actually going to do it. I want you to go to the local grocery store, wherever you go, to get your groceries. All right, so you're in the parking lot. I want you from your car to now find me a box of Oreos. So for me, if I were to go to Tops, because we're in Buffalo, New York, I'd go through the front door. From the front door, I'm going to kind of go to the right because I got to go by the produce because I don't want to walk smack into a cash register. If I then go down 3 or 4 aisles, on my right-hand side are going to be the Oreos. Then if I go straight down that aisle on the right-hand side about halfway, I'm going to see a huge Oreo display. I know exactly where those Oreos are in the store. I know exactly where I can find them. Friends, that's our business mix. That is their positioning, and that is what I'm challenging you to do to find your positioning. Too often, in talking with staffing and recruiting firms, I see businesses trying to dilute themselves by being all things to all people. So your positioning gets very, very cloudy. And if a candidate or a prospect doesn't know what it is that you offer, well, then it becomes very, very difficult to do business with you. So we need to make sure that we can strengthen and solidify that positioning so that our customers know exactly where to find us on that grocery store shelf. Now you're thinking, well, Brad, I might be in 2 different verticals. Maybe I do healthcare and I do some light industrial. Okay. So you're staring at the Oreos, right? Now I want you to go on another adventure with me. Where else might you find the Oreo brand in the grocery store? Well, if I'm looking at the cookies and I continue down that aisle and I make a left and I go all the way to the frozen section, to the ice cream section, now I know that there's going to be cookies and cream ice cream with a giant Oreo logo on it. Now that's secondary positioning, right? They're in 2 locations. So you might have good positioning in two very, very specific verticals, that's okay. But we need to make sure that that positioning is strong. And if instead it's scattered and people don't know where to find you, well, then we need to level up that positioning. We need to make sure that it's strong. We need to make sure that our customers know how to find us. And most importantly, they know what we do through and through. And more importantly, they know what's in it for them. They know what's in it for them. Friends, let's talk about leveling up your messaging. I'm a huge Simon Sinek fan. Again, if you've heard me on the TRICOM funding webinar series before, I've probably talked about Simon Sinek in one way or another. Today, I want to talk about what he calls his golden circle. People don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. Oftentimes, though, when we think about staffing and recruiting, and I'm talking to customers or I'm talking to individuals throughout the industry at maybe an association or a conference, they're selling the what. They're selling the staffing service, right? They're selling the what they do. But what we fail to do is sell why you do it. And people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it, right? So if we think about Simon Sinek, we think about the golden circle here, we need to start thinking through our messaging on our website, on our print collateral, on our social media, and get away from the what mentality and get towards the why mentality. Why should a staffing individual or why should somebody, I'm sorry, who needs staffing services work with you? Why should somebody outsource their hiring function to you when they've done it themselves for 15 years? Why should they trust you with that function now? On the candidate side, and I know this is a sales presentation, but why should a candidate trust you with their job search, with elevating their career when they're doing just fine and they're passively looking for work? If we can level up that messaging, if we can flip it on its head and instead position what we do into why we do it, well, then friends, I'm here to say we'll drive a lot more business because people buy into that messaging. People buy into the why, not necessarily the what. Because at the end of the day, there are tens of thousands of staffing firms across North America. I think the number might be 20,000-ish, right? That all offer pretty much the same service. They offer temp placements. They offer a great employee in a great role. That's what it is, right? But why they do it and why customers should trust them or why a candidate should trust them is very, very unique. So when we think about that positioning and we marry it with strong messaging, well, now we have something. And now we have something that is marketable. We have something that can be pushed out through various channels, regardless if it's digital or traditional, that doesn't matter to me. But if we have that solidified, well, then we can really get started. I want to talk about some positioning and some messaging really quick and give you one example here. And I think only the Disney example is here, but I could talk about one other. When we think about Disney, you see an example on your screen here. Every bunny smile, right? They're cute, cuddly. Disney is warm, inviting, family oriented. When you think about Disney, this is the brand that you would expect, right? And I know now I have almost a one-year-old son at home, and I'm getting very, very familiar with the Disney motto and their model and how it all works. Family-oriented, fun, friendly. They want you to be warm and welcoming and inviting. And then, friends, you might have heard of Liquid Death Mountain Water, whose spokesperson is the Thirst Executioner, who talks about literally executing your thirst. Two drastic extremes when it comes to messaging. You would not see them post something about every bunny smile. And on the other end, you most certainly would not see Disney post a message about the Thirst Executioner. They have two very independent positions, two very independent messages, and two very different target audiences, frankly. So why that's important to you is I would assume everybody on today's call, or maybe if you're watching this on replay, you probably are somewhere in the middle of that is what I would assume. But your messaging needs to be consistent and it needs to carry over from online to offline. But that messaging needs to convey from your social media to how your receptionist answers the phone. That needs to carry over to how your recruiters and how your sales team are treating individuals when they talk to them on the phone. That messaging, that branding, that brand voice needs to be consistent and carried through, regardless if it's marketing or if it's just everyday interaction. So that's another area that I would challenge you to explore and level up in 2023. Talk about leveling up your website. And this is one that we're growing more and more passionate about. If you're familiar with Haley Marketing or you're familiar with our publications or maybe some emails, our Big Ideas newsletter that we send out, you've probably heard CRO or conversion rate optimization frequently from us. It's something that to me sounds like a broken record because I'm saying it day after day. But if you're hearing it for the first time, conversion rate optimization is doing everything that you can on a website to get somebody to convert. Because at the end of the day, we're not Fox News or CNN. I don't care what side of that spectrum you're on. The point is, we don't make money on getting people to our website. We don't make money on ad revenue, right? We make money on putting people to work by filling and closing those job orders. So if you have somebody coming to your website and they're reading a blog and then they leave, what good does that do us? If you have somebody checking out your services, but they don't fill out a contact form, what good does that do us, right? Again, we are not making ad revenue off of those visitors. So we need to make sure that we're converting. Your website should be so much more than an outdated brochure telling people what you do. If on the homepage of your website, there is any mention of I or we do this or I do this, and it's so blatantly selling what it is that you do, I would really challenge you to take a look at that. We need to instead think about what's in it for me. When I'm coming to your website, and maybe I'm on my mobile device, and I'm coming to your website, frankly, I don't care who you are. I don't care what you do. I don't care what it is that you do. I care about a problem that I have. I have a need to elevate my career. I have a hiring challenge. Somebody just walked off of an assembly line and I need to make sure that machine is running tomorrow. Or maybe I had a senior team member quit and I need to fill that position yesterday, right? I have a need. You need to satisfy that need and hook me upon entry to that website, or friends, I'm going to go somewhere else. Now, if you've heard me talk before, you may have heard my plumber analogy, right? If you have a leaky faucet in your bathroom and you don't know how to fix it, right? I certainly don't. If you have a leaky faucet, you have leaky plumbing, whatever it might be, you're going to call a plumber. If they don't pick up and your sink is now starting to overfill on your bathroom floor, whatever it might be, they don't pick up, what are you going to do? You're going to call somebody else. They don't pick up, what are you going to do? You're going to call somebody else. You're going to call until that problem is resolved, right? We are in business where it's the exact same. If we have a client or a customer who has a need, the problem doesn't go away because we don't help them. The problem moves. The problem moves to your competition. It does the exact same with candidates. So we need to level up our website and focus on that conversion rate optimization to make sure that individuals can take action how and when they want to take action. So we need to think about who's coming to your website. What are those drivers that are bringing people to your website? Are you driving the right people to your website? If you're in healthcare staffing and you have great content that's driving welders to your website, well, then that doesn't matter. That fundamentally doesn't do your business any good. So are we driving the right people to your site? Why are they coming? What's in it for them and what problem are they trying to solve? What can you offer? Are you very, very clearly addressing the problems that they have, your target audience has, so that they know, hey, I can trust Brad's staffing firm because they're already talking about my pain. They're already talking about how they can solve it. They're already talking about what's in it for me. And most importantly, what can you do to avoid them? Or avoid losing them. Sorry, we certainly don't want to avoid them. Quite the opposite. What can you do to avoid losing them? When we think about conversion rate optimization, it's getting people to take action as swiftly and efficiently as possible. Let's talk about the Amazon effect. Friends, I have a great example, actually. It just happened. So you can see based on my backdrop, Haley Marketing is a remote team, so I work from home. About an hour and a half ago, a package showed up on my front door. And I looked at it and I said, I don't remember ordering anything. So I opened it up. I was like, what is this? It's a pair of shoes for my son. My wife ordered those last night at about 9:30 p.m. and they're already at my doorstep and he already tried them on at 3:20 the next day. The Amazon effect. How easy is it for you to buy whatever you want on a site like Amazon? More importantly, how easy is it for you to then get that product? The Amazon effect. if we think about reducing friction in any sort of sales process, Amazon has it down. So much so, whereas another example, I ordered a workout supplement about a week and a half ago. It took a week and a half to get to me. It's frustrating. I want it now. I want it yesterday. And when we think about the Amazon effect, other solutions and other services are always paired against that Amazon effect, right? But the point that I want to make is, how easy is it to buy or take action on a site like Amazon? Well, to buy a pair of shoes, you look it up, scroll down, you either add to cart and you swipe, or you click buy now and you swipe. And if you click buy now and you have Amazon Prime, just like that, in one swipe, you've now ordered shoes. And less than 24 hours later, they're at your door and your kid's wearing them. What are we doing on our staffing and recruiting websites to make it easy, efficient, and incredibly fast for candidates or prospects to reach out to us? Friends, I've looked at some job boards lately on some sites. It's alarming. We have individuals who are asking for social securities before we can even apply. We have multiple pages and multiple stages of an application process. To go to a contact form is asking for way too much information. We need to reduce that friction, and we need to make it easy and efficient for people to take action. Because even though you're not in the business of pairing and selling consumer goods, your candidates and your clients are pinning their experience with you to sites like Amazon, and they're comparing it. So we need to make sure that we're doing everything we can to reduce that friction and convert individuals who want to take action. Let's talk about leveling up lead generation. When we think about lead generation, we think about generating leads from what it is that we are doing. We can use digital marketing to sell our services. From an SEO standpoint, we can answer tough questions. There's a great book by Marcus Sheridan called They Ask, You Answer, which is fundamentally what SEO and content marketing does. Your target audience every day have questions. We can answer them, plain and simple. The root of it is, if you're not answering them, somebody else is. So that means that anytime somebody has a question about where to find the best staffing services in Buffalo, New York, or how to hire more efficiently in Buffalo, New York, or how to prevent individuals from walking off the job in Buffalo, New York, they're going to get that answer answered. Why not be the solution that they're looking for? So with search engine optimization, we can answer questions, we can create that long form content, and we can have a conversion path where we're answering that question, and then ultimately we're driving somebody to take action. Pay-per-click advertising. It's probably one of my favorite things to talk about lately, because I think from a staffing and recruiting standpoint, there is so much opportunity for companies because the competition levels are so low, in my opinion, when it comes to PPC. It's not a high barrier to entry, but when looking at the companies that we work with and the companies that are investing into PPC, there's a disparity there. So we can use pay-per-click advertising to get people to come back to our website. Again, let's use an example like Amazon. You look at a pair of shoes, you don't buy that product, but you go out to a site like Facebook, or you go out to a site like Fox News or CNN or whatever side you want to be on there. Again, I don't care. You go out to a site like that, and that product follows you, right? So now you see them again on Facebook. You see it again on your news site that you might go to. That's remarketing. And we can do the exact same with your services pages. We can do the exact same with your job board on your website. We can get those users to come back and take action. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, people aren't ready to take action the first time that they see something. Think about your own purchasing decisions. So if we can use pay-per-click advertising to drive individuals back to your website, well, then they can take action. We think about content marketing. I know I alluded to this a little bit when I talked about search engine optimization, but from content marketing standpoint, we want to educate, position ourselves, and build authority with our target audience. Plain and simple, that's what we're looking to do with content. Now, there's an interesting conversation that's starting to happen with ChatGPT in content marketing. Well, can I use blogs from ChatGPT, or should I create my own content? And this certainly isn't a presentation to get into AI, but I will tell you, I'm incredibly fascinated by what I'm seeing in that space whether it comes to imagery or content. So I'm going to talk on it real quickly here. And I actually didn't plan on talking about it, but I will. Content marketing exists to build authority and to educate and to position you and your organization as thought leaders and experts. Now, we in staffing and recruiting are in a people-first business. We put great people to work in great opportunities. Our differentiation is the uniqueness of each of our individuals and how it is that we make the wheels turn, right? So when we think about content marketing, your content should be focused on the insights that your team knows, those trade secrets that make your team so great. When you're thinking about something so simple as 5 resume tips to help you land your next job, right? An article that seemingly everybody has written, I promise you that your team will have a unique take on that that my team might not, or somebody else's team might not. So when we think about content marketing, I would encourage you to think about it as a way to elevate your team to showcase everything that they know to your target audience. Social media is in a way the Wild West, right? But it's a great way to get found, to network, and to get your team sharing that content that you're creating. Now, when we think about social media, I don't want to get super, super specific on which platforms to be using because truly that comes down to a full strategy specific to you and your organization. But we need to be mindful of where that target audience is living. What are they doing? What platforms are they on? What content are they digesting and consuming and looking at? And most importantly, how can we become a part of that conversation? How can we become a part of what it is that they're looking for? Oops, sorry about that. Froze for a second. We can go right on back. Not a problem. Sorry about that. Let's talk about leveling up your reputation. I think my clicker froze. When we talk about leveling up your reputation, plain and simple, 88% of individuals trust online reviews as much as they trust a review from a friend or a family member. So when we think about online reviews, 88% of people will trust an online review as much as a review from their mother. So the scary reality behind that is that your online reviews are painting a picture of your organization, whether or not you're paying attention to it, whether or not you're being mindful of it. Your online reviews are establishing who you are without your control, except you do have very, 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 very specific control over that based on your candidate experience, based on your customer experience, based on the service that you provide. You every day have an impact on your reputation. So we need to do everything that we can to showcase our organization as you know it should be. So what can we do? Well, the first is to ask for testimonials and grow those online testimonials. The majority of individuals, when prompted to do so, will leave positive feedback. I want to say it's like 92%. I don't have the number off the top of my head right now, but it's in the 90s range. Will leave online reviews, will leave that feedback if prompted to do so. The challenge there is we never ask. We never think to say, hey, I know you just said you had a great experience with me. You mind leaving that on Google? You mind leaving that on Facebook? You mind leaving that on a site like Glassdoor or wherever it might be? We need to ask. And when we have great experiences, whether it's with our customers or with our candidates, whatever it might be, we need to drive them to leave that online review and leave that testimonial. And we need to make sure that it's public, whether it's on Google, Facebook, whatever that might be, it's on our website. We need to make sure that those testimonials are painting the picture and telling our story so that we don't have to. Think about the last item that you bought, whether it's a shirt or whether it's a clicker, or maybe it's, you know, the computer that you're on. You didn't just buy it. You thought about it. You looked at reviews. You crowdsourced. You thought, oh, well, what do other people say about it? You saw one negative review about another product and you said, oh, I can't have that. Brad in Buffalo said it stunk. You don't even know Brad in Buffalo. But we're trusting those reviews, and individuals are doing the exact same with your staffing services. So if you go to Google right now and you search for your company, what picture is being portrayed? What story is being told? And the last thing that we might want to do with reputation is showcasing those awards. We all work hard. Maybe you have a clearly rated best of staffing award that you can showcase on your website. Maybe it's another industry award that you can showcase on your website. Maybe you belong to associations, or you belong to chambers of commerce, or whatever it might be. Maybe you give back to, you know, local Make-A-Wish foundations or things like that. What awards, what associations, what affiliations and accreditations do you have that you can showcase that level up your reputation? Because again, friends, that story, that picture is being told and being painted of you without your involvement. So if we can do everything that we can to have a voice, to have a say, to control the message, well, then that's how we level it up. Let's talk about leveling up our nurturing. Do more to keep your company top of mind. Nurture marketing is exactly what it is that we need to do in 2023. Friends, it's what we do as staffing and recruiting firms. It's what we do in our business. We have candidates, we have clients in our database that have been there for 20, 30 years. This is the part of the presentation where if we were in person, I would say, now, I want you to think about your candidate database. Anybody have a candidate in that database that they know they've worked with for 5 years? Raise your hand. Raise your hand and keep it up if it's been there for 7 years, 10 years, right? If you've talked to that person for 15 years, then there'd be one person in the room and I'd say, hey, how long, right? We need to do everything that we can to keep our company top of mind. We need to do everything that we can to make sure that individuals know that we care. You know, what's interesting about our work is if we put a great candidate, a great individual to work and a great opportunity, they might stay there for years. We should still stay top of mind because we don't know when they're going to be looking for that next opportunity. We don't know when a friend or a family member that they might know might be looking for their next opportunity. So we need to do everything that we can to stay in front of them. So let's talk about email marketing. If you're not actively emailing your prospect list, your candidate list, just to stay top of mind, I would encourage you to start doing that as soon as possible. And that doesn't mean we're emailing people every month trying to sell or trying to place them or trying to get them to apply. We're just offering a way to stay top of mind. Maybe it's, you know, happy Easter or seasonal IMs or greetings, right? Or maybe it's sharing great content and great resources. Or maybe, yes, it is that direct sell. And it's that direct response of, hey, apply online today or reach out for a chat, right? We need to do everything that we can through email to make sure that we're staying top of mind. With SMS and texting, 99% of text messages are opened in the first minute. Now, again, if we were live, I would ask you this in person, but how many texts have you gotten in the last 33 minutes that I've been speaking, right? And have you checked them? My assumption is yes, and that's okay, but 99% of people open a text message. I'm sorry, 99% of text messages are opened within the first minute. So what are you doing? Are you using Sense? Are you using Hearfish? Are you using any other SMS marketing automation, as we're going to get to in a second, to text your candidates, to text your clients, to text prospects, to stay top of mind so that when they need you, they know who to turn to? Again, that's the plumber analogy, right? My plumbing, knock on everything right now, is not leaking as of right now. Thank God. But when it does, and we all know it will eventually, do I know who to call? Maybe. I know who fixed it last. But if that's 5-6 years from now, hopefully, again, I got to knock on everything here. I hate water. You knock on everything, but who am I going to call when that happens? How is that company staying top of mind? How are you staying top of mind for a job seeker who might not need another role until 2030. PPC, retargeting, matched audiences, and geotargeting. Let's talk about geotargeting first. If you're working in a very, very specific geographic location, geotargeting can be great to serve ads to people within a very specific geographic radius. So if you're only doing business in Buffalo, New York, well then people in Philly and San Diego should not see your ads, and that's okay because they don't do anything for you in those locations. Matched audience. Are you serving pay-per-click ads, Google, Facebook, whatever it might be, to individuals specifically in your database? Are you showing them ads across the internet just to stay top of mind? I would encourage you to start there. I love that audience. Thirdly, retargeting. Are you getting people to come back to your website once they've already visited? We found at Haley Marketing, repeat visitors are twice as likely to apply and take action. The challenge is when we look at staffing websites and recruiting websites, it's a very low percentage of individuals and organizations who have retargeting turned on. It's easy to do. It's efficient to do. But what would happen is just like Amazon, you look at a services page, you looked at a job seeker page, you looked at jobs. Now, as you're leaving, you're seeing very specific messaging for that. I had a great example of this. I'm looking for a new pair of jeans, right? And I know it's kind of silly, but I work from home. I don't wear jeans all that often. I either wear joggers, I wear sweatpants maybe some days. I don't really have a lot of really well-fitting jeans, okay? I'll admit it. We got that out of the way. So I went to a couple different websites that I've heard of. What happened next, though, is as I went to Facebook, it's almost like those companies were fighting for my purchase by showing me Facebook ads. And I know they're fighting for my purchase because I continue to see those ads. That's retargeting. I know the brand that's top of mind right now that I'm not going to give a free plug to. I know what brand is top of mind because I continue to see their ads. Now, do they have the best jeans? I don't know. But they are nurturing the relationship that they're developing with me through pay-per-click advertising. Are you doing that with your prospects? Are you doing that with your candidates? If those two audiences are fighting for a need, right? They all have needs. They all have wants. They all have something that they're hoping a staffing firm or recruiting firm can help solve. Are you then fighting for that win and fighting for that business? Let's talk about leveling up our recruiting and master the five pillars of recruitment marketing. The first is employer branding. When we think about employer branding, it's what makes you unique. Why should individuals work with you? What is that messaging? What is that branding that screams Brad Staffing Firm? We talked about positioning. We talked about messaging. We talked about making sure that those are unique and specific to you. We talked about Oreos in the grocery store and how if I close my eyes and I'm at my house, I know exactly how to get into my car, drive to the grocery store, where to park, and how to get to a box of Oreos. Do individuals know your brand so well that they know what it is that you do, and most importantly, how it is that you can help them? Do they know that? And are you strengthening that and reinforcing that every chance you get? Second pillar is going to be your career site. Does your career site funnel individuals to take action? Or is it funneling them to not take action? If you think about your website, think about your application process. When was the last time you tried to apply to a job on your own website? If it's been more than a month, I would encourage you to go into that application this afternoon and try to apply, not just on desktop, but also on mobile. What I would also encourage you to do is have a friend or a spouse, or maybe it's a younger relative, have a son or a daughter go and apply. And instead of watching the application process, watch them. So again, instead of watching the application process, watch them. Where do they get frustrated? Do they sigh? Do they look around? Do they start to fidget? Check their body language. Do they look like they're getting bored of the process? If so, we got a huge problem. That's a giant red flag that candidates and individuals, if the individuals who love you are getting bored of your process, well, then the individuals that don't even know who you are certainly over your process. So we need to think about our career site, and we need to not just think about it on desktop, but we need to think about it on mobile. And we need to make sure that it's easy and efficient for people to take action on that mobile device. Again, if we think about the Amazon effect and we think about the opportunity to buy any sort of good or product, whatever it is that we need, and have it here in less than 24 hours, well, then candidates are expecting the same when they go to apply to a job on your site. Social recruiting. What are you doing on social media to recruit top individuals? Are you just posting your blogs? Do you just have RSS feeds set up that are firing the content that you create? Or do you have a very specific and deliberate social media strategy built around your goals? Do you have a social strategy that's quote unquote throwaway content? Are you posting content that you're doing just because you know you need to be on Facebook? Or is it actually aligned with the goal that you're trying to achieve this year? Is it aligned with the fact that you're looking for 17% growth across your business in 2023? Is it aligned very, very deliberately to what you're looking to achieve? Friends, we need to think about that. And we need to challenge ourselves to be smarter, more efficient, and more effective with our social recruiting in 2023. Job advertising. Are you funneling and shoveling buckets of money at career sites like, I'm not going to say them, but like job aggregators, right? Are you funneling money, or are you very, very specifically and deliberately using things like programmatic job advertising to make sure that you're spending the right amount at the right time to get the exact cost per application that will drive success for you? Do you know your cost per application? Do you know your cost per click? And if you know it, do you know if certain jobs are performing, are underperforming, or outperforming others? We need to be more critical of our job advertising than ever before. We cannot simply throw away money and say, oh, well, if I spend more, maybe I'll get more. That, plain and simple, is not true. We need to be smarter, we need to be better, and we need to really, really analyze that data so that we know if our job advertising is working or if we're just funneling money into another black hole. And the last is recruitment automation. When we think about recruiting, what can you offload off of your team so that they can focus on those A and B level tasks that they're very, very good at, so that they don't have to worry about the C and D level tasks? Are you automating or outsourcing some of those sourcing functions? Are you thinking about ways to stay top of mind with candidates in the recruiting process through Sense or Hearfish or through some other sort of conversation or communication automation? What are you doing to take some of that, frankly, burden off of your team so they can do what they're good at and they can do more of those A and B level tasks? Friends, when we think about leveling up our marketing mix, it's time to level up and put it all together. We talked now for about 40 minutes, and we went through 8 different ways that you can level up your mix in 2023. And I was joking ahead of time, and I told Amanda, usually this talk, at one point it was 12 strategies, and I found that I had to talk very fast to get it into an hour. And frankly, I don't like to do that. I know I already talk a little fast. I tried to slow it down a little bit for you, but it's just a part of being from Buffalo, New York, to speed things up every now and again. When we think about leveling up our marketing mix, we need to put it all together. We need to have a holistic marketing strategy that is paired with our business goals. You all know where you're trying to get to at the end of this year. And if you don't, that's exactly where you start when I say you need to leave this presentation and this conversation with one takeaway. What are you looking to achieve as a business this year? Then, does your marketing strategy and the tactics that you're deploying support or hinder that goal? Ultimately, they should support it, right? So we now have outlined 8 different strategies that we can deploy. I would encourage you today to start with one. Is it your positioning? Is it your messaging? Is it your lead generation? Is it your reputation? Is it your recruiting mix? Are we looking at digital marketing, or are we looking at various ways to control our brand voice across social or digital? What can you commit to as we look at it almost being Q2? What can you commit to in Q2 to say, listen, this is a problem and we're going to fix it? Are you going to look at your career site? Are you going to look at your job board and say, listen, it took me 25 minutes to apply to this job? There's a huge issue in that because most people are going to drop off after a couple minutes. So what can you do to improve that? We need to first holistically observe all of that, and we need to put it all together. We need to think more holistically about every single thing that we're doing and understand, is it pushing us towards our goals, or is it getting in the way, creating friction, and pushing prospects, clients, and candidates away from those goals? So why does this all matter? You know, we sat here, we talked for now 44 minutes about leveling up your mix, and why does it matter? Well, in the Great Recession, and Amanda alluded to this during the introduction, it was a great job alluding to really in outlining what today's talk was going to be. Aggressive advertisers obtained 4.5 times the market share gain versus their competitors who cut back marketing during the recession. Now, I know this is the part of the conversation where everyone says, well, Brad, work for a marketing firm. You want us obviously to do more marketing. The last thing you're going to say is that we should be cutting our marketing. Of course. But that's not it at all. I cannot wrap my head around why, when times get tough, a business would want to cut their marketing. We saw it during most recently, and I know this is talking about the Great Recession, but we saw it during the COVID era, right? You think back to 2020, you think back to when restaurants were just closing. You think about when stores were just closing because no one knew what was safe and what wasn't. The first thing you thought of when a company stopped posting on social, or when you drove by a small pizzeria that didn't have any signage, didn't have any lights on, is, oh, shoot, did they go out of business? Did we lose that company too? When people go silent on social, on digital, when marketing goes silent, people start to draw and cast their own conclusions. And frankly, the conclusions are never, oh, they must be doing great. It's usually the quite opposite. So when we think about times getting tough, we need to double down and we need to convey the message that everything is great because we can make it great. You know, our CEO, David Searns, I think the slide's coming up in a little bit and I'm gonna jump to it. Our CEO, David, says all the time, we can choose to not participate in the recession. We can choose to not participate when times get tough. We just need to think a little bit more creatively. We need to think outside the box. See, the best time to take action is before you actually need to take that action. So we don't know what's coming down the pipeline. We don't know what 2023 will bring. We don't know what tomorrow will bring. But if we can take a presentation like today or any of the others, as you listen to the TRICOM webinar series here, if you can take any piece of feedback from any of the presenters, it's that you got to get started. Because ultimately, just listening to a talk like this or by others that probably host fantastic webinars, and I know the speaker lineup, and they are great webinars. If you listen to any of those, you need to take action from it. The best time to take action is before you need to take that action. So if we get started now. And again, when it comes to a recession, we can choose not to participate. Things might get tough. That's when we can get a little scrappy. That's when we can get creative. That's when I think it actually gets a little bit more fun, right? Because we need to think outside the box. I said it earlier, if we're expecting the same return in 2023 deploying 2022 tactics, well, we're certainly not going to succeed. We need to level up every single thing that we're doing. We need to be more creative, more strategic, and we need to think of ways to reach our prospects and reach our candidates in effective and efficient ways. Friends, before I leave, we do have a couple freebies for you here, some free stuff and more. Some special offers and free advice to help you continue to level up. Of course, Amanda is going to send out this webinar recording. I would encourage you to share it with your team, share with other colleagues, share that one takeaway, right? If there was one thing that you wrote down and said, listen, Brad mentioned we need to do this, share that piece of paper with somebody this afternoon. But a couple other things, this talk is outlined in a very, very great ebook called A Guide to Marketing for Staffing Companies in a Down Economy. If you go to haleymarketing.com, you'll be able to download that ebook. I shared 7 of the strategies in that ebook. You'll get 12. So there's that math is 5. Great math, Bialy. There's 5 other strategies within the ebook that I did not present on today. So you'll get those bonuses if you go to haleymarketing.com. Again, you can download that Level Up ebook. I would encourage you to subscribe to The Secrets of Staffing Success. It's a podcast that myself and Matt Lozar, our Director of Recruitment Marketing, host every other week. We host a show called Insights, where we talk about what's working for staffing and recruiting firms in digital and recruitment marketing. You can find Insights by looking for Secrets of Staffing Success on your preferred podcast player. You can hear it anywhere podcasts are found. And of course, we do have some digital marketing bundles that we wanted to offer you today. If you're thinking about getting interested in digital marketing, you're not sure where to get started, you could always reach out to myself on LinkedIn or our team of marketing educators. Or you can check out that URL on your website on your screen right now, haleymarketing.com/digital-marketing-bundles. I'm going to ask one time, as I said, 92% of people, I believe I said, will gain positive feedback or gain some sort of feedback if prompted to do so. However, they never really ask. So I'm going to ask you now, if you have 60 seconds, I would love it if you took out your smartphone, pointed that QR code right at your computer screen, which I know sounds counterproductive, right, to point a phone at a screen. But if you get out your camera, you point it at that screen, it's going to take you to a real, real short survey. I'd love to know what you thought of the talk. I'm sure TRICOM and Amanda capture that data afterwards. I'd love to know what you thought. If there's anything that you think moving forward you should hear more of, we can certainly do that. But please, I'd love your honest feedback on today's conversation. And Amanda, if there's any questions, I'd love to stay on and answer those. I, again, want to thank you. I want to thank TRICOM for having us this afternoon. I told you I'd keep it to under 4 o'clock Eastern. We've got about 10 minutes to spare here for you.
Wonderful. Well, thank you, Brad. I appreciate you covering these in such great detail, giving our audience some amazing strategies that they can put into place right away today to level up their strategies. Again, if anyone has any questions, please go ahead and use the chat feature, or you can reach out to Brad directly. I know he'd be happy to help you one-on-one. I've also put up my contact information. If you have any questions, you can certainly reach out to me. And we will post a recording of this session on TRICOM's website, tricom.com, and we'll post on our socials as well. So doesn't look like we have any questions that have come in. I know you've covered this topic very well. Again, if you have one-on-one conversations, they can, you know, reach out to Brad and have a conversation that's very specific to their needs. So with that, I think we can wrap up today's session, but like to thank all of our participants for joining us today, and Brad and Haley Marketing for joining us and sharing their insights on level up strategies to drive sales in a down economy. Thank you all for joining. Have a great day.
Thank you.